Welcome to the Guitar Builders Basics video podcast from Crimson Guitars, episode 11 for the 6th of January 2014. Happy New Year! Today we talk about the 0° neck break angles, asymmetric neck carves, tronical tuners, fun, finessing fret slot widths, and what radius you should choose for a fanned fret or a multi-scale fretboard. We've got a good look at my first ever guitar build, which I'm going to pull out, warts and all. And one of our listeners wants to make a white fretboard with red markers, which is going to be interesting. Find me a chat on how to carve a guitar top or neck, and there are various methods. Not a tutorial, just this is a guitar builder basics, so it's going to be a brief overview on how I would do it. First of all, I must apologise. I've been gone for a couple of weeks, and well, obviously it's been holidays, but I was hoping to be back a little bit earlier. And, shall we just say the words norovirus and projectile vomiting, and leave it at that, shall we? But I'm back at work. And it turns out that what I thought would be a very quiet period with regards to tool sales and orders and all of that sort of stuff was anything but. It turns out the guitar builders and hobby guitar builders like buying tools over Christmas and New Year's. So I've come back and yeah, if you've emailed and I haven't replied to you, I will. We're ever so slightly crazily busy. And it doesn't help that I haven't been around. So yes, on to the biggest news of all at the moment. We've got another new apprentice has just started. And he's not here. I've come in on a Sunday to film this because I feel capable. And yeah, Tom has begun, and his main job actually is, finally, administration. And he is a young business student. He's going to be working here 4 days a week and doing a course in business administration and all of that the rest of the time. But what it means is that over the next month you will see great changes, and I'll be building more guitars. And somebody else will be helping to take over the various admin duties that I've missed, or just don't have the time for. It's the biggest problem I've got at the moment. I desperately want to be on the forums answering every single question. I desperately want to answer every comment on YouTube videos. And not least, I want to answer everybody's damn emails. But anyway, we're back, we're bad, we're going to be having a great year. Happy New Year, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays. Happy Holidays, that's what they say, don't they, to be more politically correct. So, yes, that's news. Other news, I've just taken delivery of a new extraction system. I'm gonna finish, wrap this up, and I'm going to just show you just the ducting from this system. It's a little crazy. What else? News. I'm going to go and show you that extraction system. Let's see. So let's go and have a look. It's just arrived. It's outside and it's very, very wet currently. Oh, I'm not going much further than that. That's just the box. That is 1.5 meters long, and that's just the box that the fan goes on. Oh, my camera's getting wet, help! So that's that. That's going to go up in our big new spray booth, and yeah, going to be fun. Now the camera is wet. You've seen my main job for the day is going to be phoning the apprentices up and saying, come in on a Sunday, you lazy people, and help us move that up into the soon to become spray booth. Alright, back to the plan. Happy New Year, ba-da-ba-bum, done. This episode is sponsored by yandles.co.uk. They are one of my favourite suppliers and hopefully soon to be partner in finding some really, really cool woods for you guys. But yeah, they basically are a timber supplier but also tool merchants. And incidentally, they are now stocking Triton tools. And there's various things going on there. So if you want to go and see, feel, touch, caress one of the new Triton routers that I've been playing with recently, or that huge 7-inch industrial size hand planer, etc., go over to Yandles in Somerset. They are phenomenal. Also, don't forget that my ugly mug is currently on the cover of Good Woodworking magazine, which is pretty awesome. I will not lie. I went into a newsagent the other day and said, oh, by the way, I had my daughter with me, so I couldn't go and browse the shelves myself. I said to the young guy, do you have Good Woodworking magazine? And he sort of ruffled over and spent 5 minutes looking, and he pulled one out. He said, is this the one? And I said, well, look at it. And he looked at the cover and, oh! And I have really felt quite so pleased with myself. So, yes, that's very, very cool. Very, very cool. What more can I say? Yes, so we're on the cover, and they wrote a fantastic profile piece on us. Possibly a little bit too positive, but then again, I'm a craftsman, and I always think that half of what I do isn't quite good enough. I think that you cannot be a top artist and craftsperson without that slight niggle of doubt in your own self-worth or talent. I think that's quite healthy. Anyhow, get your copy at getwoodworking.com/shop, and they've got various other articles and free content up on there. So getwoodworking.com/shop, and you can buy the episode, you can buy the magazine there, and I would appreciate it if you did, because it's so cool. Alright, let me have a look. Oh yes, one of the issues with having quite so many orders over Christmas is that I ran out of notched straight edges. We had loads, and within a couple of days of going on holiday, it seems, that wasn't enough. But what it does mean is that the next stage in our tool making has been broached, and our notched straight edges, while they're still being painted black so that they work better so you can see the gaps better, are now being made out of stainless steel, and as such are stronger and better and stainless. Not many of you keep your straight edges in sheds, but one chap has done, and he phoned me up and said, why is it rusting? Was it in a pool of water? Oh yes, that will possibly be the reason, sir. Alright, so anyhow, and yes, fret rockers as well. We've been making them. I like lightweight fret rockers. They've been made out of aluminium, and we made them out of steel at one point, and they felt a bit we've been through three or four different variations or iterations now. I'm sticking with aluminium, but they're going to be 4 millimeters thick now, as opposed to the piddly 2.5 or 3 that most people use. So they're going to be more positive to feel, and I'm also doing away with sharp corners. So I'm going to make them slightly larger than usual, but with instead of 4 sides, they're going to have 7 or 8 or something. Yeah. And it's going to make it less likely that you damage yourself or your instrument when you're when you're playing, working, setting up your guitar. Do you get the idea that perhaps my job is a bit of a game? I love it so much. Anyhow, okay. I've had enough of this news. Let us get on with the question. This is from a forum user, Drapok. And he says, I'm about to embark on 2 guitar builds simultaneously. One is a through neck with a walnut body and spalted maple, half-inch thick cap with a three-piece neck, walnut, purple art, walnut, and maple veneers between the main pieces. That sounds pretty awesome. The other is a set neck, Hawaiian monkey pod. I'd want to play with that just for the name. Hawaiian monkey pod with a three-piece mahogany neck, again with the aforementioned maple veneers. I was thinking of using a tunematic style bridge with the through body stringing anchoring setup. So now to the question regarding the break angle. I was planning to recess the bridge into the top and keep a zero break angle. Is this a bad idea? If not, why don't more people do it? Tradition! Remind me never to sing on the podcast. Alright, several things. I've done this many, many times, mainly because I was lazy and didn't know, was scared of. I did one geometry, trigonometry, I can't even remember what the class was called, but I remember angles and protractors and scary things. I have been in the past, I'm much better now because of my job, numerically dyslexic. It turns out that you can actually practice these things and retrain your brain, which is interesting. But yeah, numbers scared the bejesus out of me. And geometry and working out angles and that sort of stuff, even more so. Even today, I get little palpitations. So yeah, I did one class at school and I probably got kicked out because I was so bad. So angles are scary. I've done that where I've recessed the bridge and then you have to recess the pickups and the pickup surrounds in order to get that to work. And the biggest issue really is from the guitarist's point of view. It feels weird, it feels strange. Fenders have a zero break angle obviously, but they're set quite high up. But when you're playing a Les Paul type, it just feels wrong. You're used to that 3.5 degree or 4 degree break angle and how high the strings are above your instrument. So that's the one thing, it just feels a little bit off. The other is, as I've mentioned, you're going to have to either get remarkably low pickup surrounds and then have your pickups also recessed, which isn't a problem. Off the top of my head, I'm pretty sure organic guitars, they were rather large in the UK a few years ago, CNC made custom guitars, but yeah, they recess everything and it looked all right and it feels quite cool and funky. It looks modern and I like the idea. I've done it, as I said. But as we learned in the podcast 3 or 4 episodes ago, we were talking about sound and sustain and how all of that works. And one of our users, Mr. Minimalist SWM, I suspect his name is, or Minimal SWM, he's got some sort of a physics background, and he was saying that the closer the strings are to the body, the less the strings are going to sound and vibrate. And that also goes for neck action, I suppose. It's basically, as your string vibrates, it kicks out sound waves, and if the sound wave, so you've got your string, the sound wave goes bump, bounces straight back and hits the string, and it counteracts the vibration of the strings, and therefore you lose some of the sustain, and it cancels out or enhances certain frequencies, but the general effect is that it slows the vibration down of the string, and therefore your sustain. So that is another thing. If you've got a zero break angle and your strings are particularly close to the body, then you're going to feel sonically limited, I suspect. If you check out our Delta One guitar, that it's a phenomenal design. The client is an architect, and from his guitar designs, I suspect a particularly talented one. And hi, Jim. I love his design, but what we decided to do was have the fretboard start and just keep on going right through to the end of the body at that same level. with the pickups recessed and the bridge completely recessed. So it means that the strings were only 4 or 5 millimeters above the body itself. And I didn't know what effect that would have on the strings. I didn't even, on the sound, I didn't even consider it. So, and that guitar, it sounds great. I mean, we really did very, very well. But I suspect that if we'd done it in a more traditional way, it would sound better. Let me have a look. So, I've got in my notes here that overall it might look like a Les Paul, but obviously using different materials as well, it won't sound exactly the same because of that design. And the biggest thing as well, especially if you're used to playing the Les Paul type instrument, if you've got your top much closer to the strings, you're going to bang that top with your plectrum every chance you get and scratch it and make ticking sounds through your recordings. So that might be something else to do. But with clever design and thought, I love the look. And that, this is the problem, this is the dichotomy. I love the look of having a recessed bridge and recessed tremolos and low strings, and it feels better, it feels modern and sexy. And if you can counteract the sound things, maybe just by having the top slightly further away, just have your fretboard slightly thicker where it sits on the top. Have your fretboard 7 or 8 millimeters thick instead of 5 or 6, and that will give you a little bit more air between the body and the string as it vibrates. And I suspect that would do very, very nicely. All right, on to the next question. Big Oak on the forums again. Remember, go and join the forums, crimsonguitars.com/guild/forum. We really appreciate your support. If you become a paid member, it helps keep the podcasts going, and quite frankly, I'm a struggling guitar builder and need your help to pay Tom the apprentice, please. Anyway, I digress again. Big Oak on the forums asks, or says, I wanted to ask about asymmetrical necks and what everybody and Ben's thoughts are. I realized today that I don't see them very often, and Ernie Ball, which were manufactured 20 miles from where I grew up, oh, I'd love to do an Ernie Ball factory tour. I currently bear the Ernie Ball eagle as a tattoo on my arm there. I didn't realize that they would, in effect, be a competitor to me in the long run. But yeah, I'm a fan. 20 miles from where he grew up. They seem to be one of the few big names that use them. And thinking about it, most of the places that sell necks don't seem to have the option. I suspect they don't even know that it is an option, given how blinkered most suppliers are. It seems to me they would be more comfortable, but I don't know much. Big Oak, you're the gentleman who talked to us about helical cutters. So far, nobody has found that I've managed to see a helical router cutter like you were talking about. And if somebody decides to manufacture one, give it to me. Asymmetrical necks. Yes, I've made them. I love them. And they're wonderful. Effectively, at the base, well, look at my fingers here. Imagine that's your fretboard. This is the base side, thick and thin. And just curve it out a little bit better. And effectively, it does make for a more comfortable neck. I would be seriously tempted to do an asymmetrical neck like that with fanned frets and a twist. And that sounds like it should be the single most comfortable guitar neck ever made. And one day when I have half a second of time, I will do just that. But yeah, effectively, it fits your grip better. As you can see, that's the shape of my hand. It makes absolute sense. People are scared witless about twist and strength and stability of necks. My first instruments, the necks were hugely thick because I thought that it had to be a baseball bat to counteract the tension of the strings. And quite frankly now, if you've all seen wizard necks, and they can be incredibly thin, especially if you're making a neck with multi-laminates, there's no reason to worry about twist. So having one side thicker than the other, you would worry that it's going to, the higher tension on the one side is going to cause issues with twisting in the long term. And as I think about it, did you catch the pause in the gears working there? As I think about it, there's probably more tension on the treble side anyway. So, or is it the other way around? My brain is freaking out now. I need to have a look. I've got a chart somewhere that shows me what the tension is per string. And I suspect that it isn't even across your neck anyway. So having an asymmetrical neck might even out the stresses and strains on your neck. Anyway, so yes, asymmetrical necks, I love them. I think they're comfortable. I think they are logical. Exactly the same as fan frets. I think they're comfortable and I think they're logical and surprisingly easy to play with as well. Surprisingly easy to get used to. And then you go and you play with actually making a proper twist so that the headstock, as it goes towards the headstock, it twists away from you so that you're causing less, your wrist isn't twisting as much. These things are logical. They are scientific, they are ergonomic. The catchphrase of the decade, or last decade probably. But guitarists are, surprisingly, an incredibly conservative bunch. And unless they're actually going to sit down and play a stock instrument that I've made with these features and suddenly fall in love with it, most guitarists aren't interested. They just don't want to know. They're not going to take the risk. They're not going to buy a custom guitar and say, oh, do you know what? I'm going to spend £3,000 on this beautiful guitar. And I'm just going to, what the hell, twist the neck for me. I'll play with that. Most people don't have the money. I don't have the money to go and commission something that I'm not used to play. So most people will come and they'll order a Les Paul type or, you know, something with a C-shaped neck. And they'll be happy because it's what they're used to. And, I mean, there is room, possibly, for somebody who's going to go presetalize and take twisted neck fan frets to every single guitar shell on the planet and say, hey, check this neck out, it's asymmetric, isn't that comfortable? Hey, buy one of my guitars. And I think there is certainly room for that. Tronical tuners. Check out the show notes, please. There's going to be a link to a short little video that's doing the rounds at the moment. You've probably seen it already. Some band, I can't even remember now, Alien Ant Farm or something like that, just showing off his tuners. And I actually lost a very big order 3 or 4 years ago because the client wanted two guitars to go on tour with and he desperately wanted Tronicals on it. And Gibson owned them, or owned them, and I can't keep track of who owns what anymore these days. And they were not selling to anybody other than themselves. And I lost that client as a result. He had to go and buy the horrible Gibson robot guitars. Have you seen the stuff? Dusk Tiger or something. Have you seen the things that Gibson are turning out these days? My God. Anyway, sorry, a complete digression. Check the video out. Tronical tuners, automatic tuning things, push a button, go tweel, and your guitar is in tune. Awesome. Absolutely awesome. And this brings me to, I wasn't supposed to really be talking about this yet, but this podcast is going out on Monday night, Tuesday night. Check out the website. There's going to be a very, 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 very cool new sections to the site. And we are introducing a whole new range called the Boutique Range. And effectively it's custom guitars, but you can sit there and go through a checklist and it'll tell you exactly how much it costs and what the options are, and you can build your own instrument and yeah, buy it through the shop, effectively. It should take three or four months to build, and they are going to be absolutely awesome. And Tronical tuners are going to be an option. So, yes, this is the next stage in our lives. As you've seen, I haven't got very much time, and I want to spend all of my time making the custom guitars that I actually want to build. And the way I'm doing that, and trying to free up my time to be able to devote 5 or 6 times more, that sentence was not thought out. I want to be able to spend an inordinate amount of time making a guitar perfect, regardless of what the client has paid me. And I need to subsidize that somehow. So we're doing some relatively stockish things that can be turned out almost automatically. You know, we're going to have jigs to make proper radiuses on the fretboards, and we're going to, you know, you can turn around and say, okay, I want a Fender or a Gibson scale length, or I want this neck or that neck, and you've only got the two options. But put 50 options where you've got 2 or 3 or 4 different variations, and suddenly you've got trillions of combinations and custom guitars. So anyway, please check out the website, crimsonguitars.com/... I don't even know what the URL is yet. It's coming. It is coming. All right. On YouTube, how do you say your name? The DJF Sun, I think, asks, if you would use one of those jumbo frets, in fact, this isn't even a question, this is a question and a top tip from another viewer. He says, if you were to use one of those jumbo frets, for which the Japanese saw makes the cut too narrow, how would you enlarge the cut? So far I'm using a Dremel with one of those thin abrasive discs, but the result is very uneven. And Avi GTR answered, sandpaper, 150 to 220 grit, folded over itself, i.e. cutting on both sides, will fit in the slot with a slip fit. Drag the paper through the slot until your ideal sized feeler gauge, 0.023 of an inch to 0.027 of an inch. I still don't understand inches. I have no clue what you're talking about. It's small. Will fit, adding a 0.001 to 0.005 of an inch feeler gauge between the folded sandpaper if necessary. To get the slip fit compression, you need to abrade the fret slot sides. This is more difficult on pre-bound fingerboards, but still practical. Thank you, Avi GTR. Effectively, quite frankly, I agree. To a certain extent, if I was going to be using jumbo frets, I would cut the slots bigger in the first place. I do have several other saws that have got a wider kerf on them, and I would go with that. The issue with sandpaper is that there is the potential for it to cut unevenly and therefore knock your fret out by a small, probably insignificant amount. But yeah, I think that that way sounds good. I would be more tempted to use the feeler gauge as the tool and actually wrap sandpaper around a small feeler gauge so that you've got something other than just the paper as the tool, depending on how stiff your sandpaper is, basically. Other than that, yeah, there are... I can't think of any other way. That's how I would do it. If anybody else has got any other ideas, please, as I've said many times, I'm desperate to learn through this process as well. And your tips and tricks, I'm using the cloud to teach me better ways or more interesting ways to do my job. And yeah, please, your feedback is most welcome. Let's go. Aha! Andy Prokopic. There we go. on YouTube asks, if you're building a fanned fret instrument, I understand that when laying out the scale lengths, you calculate the fret spaces for each individual scale length and draw a straight line from each note space in a diagonal fashion. In other words, you've got your low E and your high E strings. Your low E wants to be a 648 mm scale, and your high E wants to be a 629 mm scale, i.e. Fender and Gibson. And you mark those scales at the string position and then join those two dots, dot, dot, draw a line between them, and that's your scale. So effectively, your A string will be somewhere in between. Having never held a fan fret instrument myself, how is the radius set up on one of these instruments? Are they generally perfectly flat, or is there some sort of complex 3D dimensional shape outline by the fingerboard? Similar to how a standard radius outlines a cylinder and a compound radius outlines a cone. I hadn't even ever considered that you would do anything other than just have a 12-inch radius or a 12 to 18-inch radius. There's nothing special to do, nothing clever. I think he goes on to ask about, at some point... next paragraph! You can tell I'm not quite professional yet. I've been thinking this out in my head, but my limited spatial cognition leaves me a little stumped. I hope this is a good question, etc., etc. I love your videos and love people, seeing people working with hand tools. I tend not to read the people telling me how much they love me, because, well, it's slightly embarrassing. Hi, I love me too. It's a guitar. It's a standard guitar. The difference, even a fanned fret, a standard fanned fret, isn't going to be fanned over. So if you've got your horizontal, it might start there and move 5 mm to the one side. The radius, even if you've got a cone or some complex 3D shape working with the radius, the difference between that position and one 5 mm away isn't going to be vast. So if you've got a 12-inch radius, just do a 12-inch radius. It's going to be 12 inches, whether it's fanned or not. And even if you are using a multi-scale. Even if you are using a... I can't remember what it's called now. My brain has fried. If your radius goes from 9.5 inches to 20 inches, and a compound, it's a compound radius. How embarrassing. Even if you are using a compound radius, there isn't going to be that much of a difference between along each individual fret. So I wouldn't worry about it. It's are you an engineer? It's the sort of thing that it's the sort of level of precision that is just one step more than you need to worry about. Good question. It made me think, but not necessary. Alright, finally, One Piece Guitars on YouTube says, he references the last podcast and asks to see my first ever guitar. He says, it will be good to see you do things wrong. And trust me, this is a constant learning process. I do things wrong all the time. And I'm just going to go and dig out that guitar and show you. Let's see. Here she is. I'll give you the brief overview. I went and bought an African mahogany body blank at least, and Wenger fretboard with abalone dots. Crikey. And so effectively, I used to be called Scorpion Guitars, Scorpion Instruments. 3rd of the 1st, 2003. That was after the last iteration of this. I actually finished it the first time around, sometime in 02, after about 6 months of building. And before then, I'd been building violins at college for a while.
That's quite cool, actually. That's, you can't really see, but effectively that's actually engraved and etched into the top and then into the headstock, sorry, and then painted, so that's tactile. I quite like that effect. And, you know, the headstock isn't too bad, actually. I was using those horrible, horrible U-channel truss rods. They're unstable and nasty. I didn't know about notching the ends of the frets to go inside the binding, so that went right through. What else? I mean, the carve isn't too bad. Like I said, at that point I'd been building violins, so I knew how to carve things, but I didn't know about scale lengths. And what the problem is, I was looking at, I'll come around the other side of the bench here and show you, this book by Martin Koch is the one I actually used. And there are numbers down that side, and then there are numbers inside. And I wanted a PRS scale, 635 mil. Can you hear the rain in the background? It's really coming down now. Anyway, flooding all over the place in the UK at the moment. So yes, sorry, I digress. I wanted a 24 fret PRS scale. So I think I started from that measurement, but number 24 there ends up being 397 there, which is actually fret number 17. So instead of 24 frets, I ended up with, well, I ended up with 18. And a funny, funny scale. So my bridge is very far away from where it's supposed to be. And my tailpiece was even further away from the bridge than it should be, just to keep the tension up. And it was, you know, it was nasty. The lacquer I used, I suspect, was a paint-on oil varnish from, you know, violin type making. What I did right, almost, there's a sort of a tenon under there, and that's quite cool, although I shouldn't have let the fretboard stay quite so raised. I should have bound the end of the fretboard as well. That just looks weird. And the back is, yeah. As I've said, my neck is really chunky. Now, I did a set neck with a nice tenon, and you can see where I've carved through the tenon in order to get a more comfortable thing. And then I freaked out and got scared and decided to over-engineer and thought I'd put some screws in. And what an ugly, ugly mess. And I suspect an unnecessary ugly mess. So, well, there you have it. I mean, look at that. Thinking back, I didn't have a router. I didn't own a router at this point. I cut that out by hand for the most part, and then I bought a Dremel multi-tool, thinking that would be a good substitute for a big router. Bear in mind, I was being taught violin making, and I didn't know routers existed before I started doing this. So yeah, I did all of that. I chewed it out very slowly with a small cutter and a Dremel. So yeah, all I can say is I have seen many, many first guitars made by people nowadays on our forums and on YouTube that are hundreds of times better than this. But then again, when I started, we didn't have YouTube. I'm a pre-YouTube person. It's crazy. Anyway, my first guitar. Enjoy.
Please forgive me. Well, I've built somewhere in the region of 140 instruments since then. and it has... I'm still learning. And, well, my second guitar wasn't as good as my first. My second got burnt. Still have my third upstairs somewhere, and that's diabolical as well. But anyway, what can you do? You all start somewhere. Now, on to the questions. Ethan Lord has an interesting idea. He says, I want to make a white fretboard with red frets. See, I misread that when I copied that. I thought he said fret dots. I want to make a white fretboard with red frets for my Les Paul style build. I've scoured the internet and found no attempts at either of these. Is it possible in any way? Does anybody have any creative ideas? White fretboard, yes, you can do that. If by white you're not even talking about maple, which is a light wood, obviously creamy when you've got finishing on, etc. If you want pure white, the easiest way is to paint, actually. Just get a standard hardwood, paint it, and then lacquer the hell out of it, and it will be just like a standard maple neck where you have to lacquer it, and at some point in the future you might well wear through the lacquer and have to repaint it. But there's no reason why you can't paint a fretboard. I have toyed with the idea of staining fretboards in the past and then adding a finish. People stain funny woods to make them look like ebony all the time, the cheeky bastards. But there's no reason why you can't have a green fretboard or something if you want to go all out. Again, guitarists are conservatives, so unless you're making it something for yourself and you want something like that, or you have a particularly adventurous customer, you're not likely to be asked to do these things. The other option, for the whiteness at least, is something that we mentioned last week, and that's a composite material. You can quite easily go and make yourself a fretboard, well, cast yourself one out of resin, and instead of painting wood, you'll just stain your resin white or use a white epoxy, and just make yourself a cast, and you're away. I say just, I'm sure it's actually rather difficult, but it can be done, it is possible. There's several ways to do it. Red frets? No. I mean, I can't think of any metals that are bright red, and it needs to be metal, really. You've got copper, too soft. There are brass frets, so goldish. I can't think of any material. You don't want to start trying to make your own frets, basically. That way lies madness, says the man who probably will at one stage try and make his own frets. But, yeah, red frets, the best you could do is goldish. So do a Google search for hypoallergenic frets and go from there. That's about the best I can do for you, I'm afraid. But, yeah, the white fretboard. That's a pretty cool idea. I really would like to make a black and white guitar where everything is actually, it looks like a black and white photo. I think monochrome. I think that would be pretty phenomenal, actually. So there we go. What have I got here? My favorite comment. My favorite comment on the carving video. I'm sure you've seen the PAF25 video build series where I go from start to finish in 15 videos. The instrument was supposed to be built in 24 hours, and it ended up taking 25. But, I came across this comment the other day. This chap's name is Death From Above 1981, and he says, he said, I don't know. He said, guitars by Bane, you merely adopted the sawdust. I was born in it. it's cool, good man. There was, however, another interesting question from Cody Carrig on that video. There'll be a link to the video in the show notes at crimsonguitars.com/workshopdiary/something. It's in the menu up at the top right. He says, is there an alternative to the angle grinder? that maybe isn't so violent. I don't care if it takes longer, but I'd rather have a little more control. That tool intimidates me. If you've been watching my videos, you know that in the interests of speed and trying to make a living making guitars, I've started using an angle grinder with either the Holy Galahad metal disc with very sharp points in it, or one of those flap wheel discs with sandpaper on it that metal workers use. And you have a surprising amount of control when you do that. It looks scary, and it does, especially if you've got coarser grits, it does remove a lot of wood very rapidly. But with a little bit of practice, that method, I can carve a guitar neck in 15-20 minutes probably, and a body 15-20 minutes as well. And it makes a heck of a lot of dust, and it's fun, but scary. The traditional way is to get yourself a mallet, like so, and a gouge. And this is my gouge that I used for many years. And clamp your bit of wood to your bench and remove the wood and carve. And that is fun. It's fun. It's organic, and you tap away and you end up carving this. Yeah, the guitar just appears out of the wood, basically. Slowly and organically and carefully, and you have control. You have to sharpen your gouge several times. I'll do a video. I will show a video of how to do it like this. And then once you've got your... And that's how I made this guitar. Once you've carved, you've got these huge sort of runnels in it where your gouge has been. Then you start playing with little curved thumb planes, and these go along and smooth it down a little bit, and then you can have your scrapers and scrape away the wood. And it sounds more difficult than using an angle grinder, but it really isn't. As long as you've got sharp tools, there is no reason why even an absolute novice cannot hand carve a very, very nice guitar that way. Now, I don't use... Oh, here's another. This is a little plane that it's got a curve on the bottom, and effectively it's a curved spokeshave without the arms. And I use this a lot. But another option is a spokeshave. This one has a flat bottom, but if you get one with a curved bottom, you can do carving of bodies. And a lot of people use these to carve necks as well. One of my favorite tools of all time is the Shinto Japanese saw rasp, or saw file. On one side it's like a hacksaw blade, and on the other it's much coarser. This, when I was introduced to this, it was taking me 2 days to carve a neck, and I wanted to kill myself. This thing can take a square neck blank, and in an hour or two you'll have something that is done, basically ready for sanding. This is great. I remember once using a spokeshave to make a neck, and I just didn't get on with it. I think to carve a neck with a spokeshave, you need jigs or more innovative ways to clamp the neck down than I had at the time. I suspect. I'm going to play with it. Again, it's something that I need to... sorry, I keep on looking at this first guitar and going, ooh, do that differently. Yeah, so that is... That's the traditional method. Basically, you use gouges or files and rasps, and you just go at it by hand. You can even use a carving knife sort of to pare away and whittle yourself a neck. And there are many, many methods, and all of them are valid. It depends on what you want to do. If you don't want to make dust and noise, then that's a very good one. And then in the end, you get yourself out a cabinet scraper. And this conversation keeps on reminding me of videos I need to make. I need to do one on sharpening cabinet scrapers. And then you finally end up with something that you can sand down with your random orbital or sanding block. Another option is a dupli carver or copy router or something like that. And I mentioned our new boutique range of instruments, and those are going to be made predominantly using a copy router. So it's still going to be a person standing there with a router, but they're going to have a template that I've carved by hand, and that router will have a pin and a router cutter, and they move at the same time in several axes. So the apprentice is going to basically carve a top by using my template and going like so. Do not be tempted, don't even consider thinking about possibly maybe using an Arbitech to try and carve your instrument. If you're scared of using an angle grinder with a flat wheel and a Holy Galahad disc, the Arbitech is code brown, change my pants, and go and buy a new bit of wood. Scary. I've done it quite a lot. I thought that was the best way to do it, and I tried to master it. And, oh my. It is rough. Effectively, it's a chainsaw disc, teeth type disc, and with a depth stop and all of that, and you know, there is the potential there for it to work, but don't, just don't. It's so scary. I started whispering there. We're in a horror movie now. I screwed up a heck of a lot of neck blanks trying to carve necks using that, and you cannot get anywhere near the level of precision that you can with the angle grinder. So there we have it. There we have it. That was today's show. And thank you very, very much for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe. Go to the Crimson Guild online luthier school and check out the videos. And basically every single one of the 70 or 80 YouTube videos we've got up are up there. Plus, guild members have got access to even more videos following the new Clarity build, for one. And there's a new tutorial series on how I'm making my workbench, and various other things going up as we speak, or as soon as I can spend some more time editing video. So thank you for subscribing, thank you for your support. Do not forget to send in your questions, either in the forums or on the YouTube comments. We need questions to keep this show alive. Thank you. Good night.